Hello everyone, welcome to StudyIQ. My name is Prashant Dhawan. So continuing our Countries of the World series, in this video we shall learn about Kazakhstan, Central Asia's powerhouse. But before we begin, I would like to tell all of you about StudyIQ's pen drive and tablet courses. If you are preparing for any examination, then our courses are there to help you. Our courses are available for pretty much every examination, SSC exam, bank exam, RBI grade B, UPSC exam as well, KVS, DSSB, CLAT. So all these pen drive and tablet courses are available on studyiq.com. You can visit this website and you can call these numbers as well for more information. First of all, let's locate Kazakhstan on the world map. This is our country, India. And if you look at the Central Asian countries, you will see this gigantic country, Kazakhstan, right in the middle. As you can pretty much observe, it is a landlocked country. What do I mean by a landlocked country? It does not have access to any of the major oceans in the world. Suppose if you want to take a cargo from Kazakhstan to the Indian Ocean, you simply will not be able to do that. You do have access to the Caspian Sea, but unfortunately, Caspian Sea itself is a landlocked sea. Caspian Sea does not have access to the Mediterranean or the Arabian Sea or the Bay of Bengal, does it? So that is why Kazakhstan is the largest landlocked country in the world. Now observe that it shares border with Russia, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, China. I will mention all the countries that Kazakhstan does indeed share its border with. But I would like to draw your attention to a very important thing here. A lot of times students tend to get confused when they look at the world map. They assume that Kazakhstan and Mongolia share some border. Apparently they do not. If we zoom in a bit, you can clearly see Kazakhstan and Mongolia share not even an inch of any international border. Alright, there is a lot of distance between both the countries, and that is why Kazakhstan and Mongolia, they do not share any border. Make sure to remember this, do not get confused. Now coming back to the landlocked part, what exactly is the definition of a landlocked country? You see, a landlocked state or a landlocked country is a sovereign state entirely enclosed by land, by a number of countries or one country, it doesn't really matter, or whose only coastline lies on a closed sea. Of course, Caspian Sea is a closed sea. That is why we consider Kazakhstan a landlocked country. Alright, so don't get confused that how can it be a landlocked country when it has coastal line with the Caspian Sea, because the Caspian Sea itself is a closed sea. So the country of Kazakhstan shares borders with Russia, China, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan. Five countries only. Kazakhstan is a very influential country as well, although it is not perceived to be one in the international stage or perhaps the mainstream media. It is often overlooked when it comes to powerful Central Asian countries, but believe me, Kazakhstan is indeed a powerhouse in every sense. Kazakhstan is a member of the United Nations, the World Trade Organization, the CIS. What do I mean by the CIS? We are talking about the Commonwealth Independent States. This is a group of countries that mainly consists of the former Soviet states. They try to make sure that there is good trade relations between them. They sign pacts, they make sure that custom duties are not levied. So they help each other out in trade. Then the Eurasian Economic Union as well. This economic union consists of the European countries and the Central Asian countries. Then this very, very important group, CSTO. This is often called Little NATO. This CSTO is Collective Security Treaty Organization. It was built on the lines of NATO. I will talk about this, but let's just discuss all the other organizations, then we will come back to this. This is quite important. Of course, SCO, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, India is a part of it as well. Then OSCE. OSCE is the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. So over here, they talk about human rights and weapon control. European countries and the Central Asian countries together, they cooperate with each other. And then TurkSOY. TurkSOY stands for International Organization of Turkic Culture. If you look at this map, all these countries that are highlighted on this map, they are part of the Turkic culture. There is a lot of similarity in terms of culture between Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and of course parts of Turkey as well. A lot of people, thousands of years ago, they migrated from Kazakhstan to Turkey, and this migration never really stopped. This sort of developed into a pattern, and many people, they slowly started migrating from this region to other parts. But even though they are on different countries, they share the same culture, pretty much the same way of life. So that is why they have a lot of similarities, and they created this group to celebrate that, the Turksoy group. Collective Security Treaty Organization. What exactly is this? In 1991, when the USSR collapsed, the biggest worry of the Russian Federation was, what if NATO manages to get a hold of one of these countries, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, Belarus? What if one of these countries decide to join NATO and there are NATO bases in one of these countries? That will undermine Russia's security to a large extent. That is why Russia created the Collective Security Treaty Organization. It is basically a defense treaty where if a country, hypothetically speaking, attacks Kazakhstan, that means that country is attacking Russia as well. Of course, Russia did not do it to have more military allies in form of Belarus, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan. Certainly, if a country dares to attack Russia, then obviously these small Central Asian countries will not be able to do much about it, since that attack will be so massive. But these countries were recruited in this group primarily because this group has a very important clause. Once a country becomes a member of the Collective Security Treaty Organization, that country cannot join any other defense pact. That means these countries cannot become NATO members. So in order to ensure that none of the Central Asian countries join NATO, Russia created this defense pact, and it still exists, although it certainly is nothing in comparison to NATO. But you can have a look at all the member countries here. There are two non-member observer states as well, and those two countries are Afghanistan and Serbia. They joined this group in 2013. So if any country decides to attack Afghanistan, these countries are not obliged to jump in and attack that country, since Afghanistan is not a full member. So no country in the world will probably ever attack Kazakhstan because of the Russia factor. Of course, if a country does indeed want war with Russia, then we are looking at a much larger war. So Kazakhstan's security is pretty much guaranteed because of Russia, but the influence of Russia doesn't stop here. You will see many Kazakhstani people, they tend to talk more in Russian than their own native language, Kazakh. The government of Kazakhstan has often tried to change this. They try to promote the national language, but Russian still predominantly is used everywhere in Kazakhstan. Even on the Kazakhstan television channels, you will see more Russian shows than Kazakhstani shows. So you can see both the countries are culturally quite similar, and they still are quite close together, even though the USSR has fallen. But even after all of that closeness and the good relations that both the countries share, there is one dispute, the Yukati Island dispute. The Yukati Island is an important island in the Caspian Sea. It is located off the eastern end of the mouth of the river Volga. Volga, as you know, is the largest river, not just in Russia, but in the entire European continent. According to the Russian administration, this island belongs to Russia. Of course, Kazakhstan believes that this island belongs to Kazakhstan. Allow me to show you where this island is located. So look at this map. This is our lovely country, India. If you go to the northern side, you will see this is the Caspian Sea. In the northern part of the Caspian Sea, you will see the Yukati Island. Now, of course, both the countries, Russia and Kazakhstan, they believe this is a part of their territory, primarily because this island is surrounded by a lot of oil and natural gas. Certainly one thing that has a lot of value in today's world. So both the countries are eyeing this place. But this issue hasn't really affected the relations between both the countries. Then we have to talk about the very important Vozrozhdeniya Island in the Aral Sea. The Aral Sea is a sea, well, it isn't exactly a sea anymore. There was a time when it really was a sea. It provided water to all the villages around its area. But right now it is quite dry. It is often called one of the planet's worst environmental disasters because it really is quite dry right now. Most of its water is gone, and it is because of over-exploitation of water and other factors as well. So the Vozrozhdeniya Island is in the Aral Sea, and it is shared by Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan. In 1954, the Soviet Union constructed a biological weapon test site called Aralsk 7 there, and on the neighboring island as well. So right now that place is not fit for living because of all those biological weapon tests. People don't go there. That is why it is quite famous. So have a look at this map right here. This is Kazakhstan and this is Uzbekistan. Between Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan, you will find the Aral Sea. Alright, now I'm using Google Earth to show you this. And there was a time when there was a lot of water in the Aral Sea, but as you can see, it has dried up to a large extent. Certainly, future looks quite bleak for mankind since we are exploiting our natural resources so quickly. Then we should talk about Baikonur Cosmodrome, a very important place. Allow me to explain its importance. In 1991, when USSR broke up, before that, none of the Russian leaders, none of the Soviet leaders rather, ever thought that the USSR will break up and Kazakhstan will become an independent nation. So during the 1960s, during the space race between USA and USSR, where both the countries were trying to outdo each other, during that time, a very important space station, you can say, a site where satellites can be launched, was built in Kazakhstan. Of course, at that time, Kazakhstan was not an independent country. It was part of the Soviet Union. This area was called Baikonur Cosmodrome. This is quite important. And after USSR disintegrated, the Russian Federation found itself to be in a very difficult position because it was not in the possession of the Baikonur Cosmodrome anymore. It was part of Kazakhstan. So the Russian Federation made a deal with the Kazakhstani government where they would pay millions of dollars to the Kazakhstani government every year for leasing this Baikonur Cosmodrome till 2050. This area is quite important primarily because both Sputnik 1, the first artificial satellite, and Vostok 1, the first human spaceflight, were launched from Baikonur Cosmodrome. Of course, in Vostok 1, Yuri Gagarin became the first human being to enter space. So this is a very important site, not just for its historic significance, but for its strategic use as well. So that is why inside Kazakhstan, this area has been leased to Russia. So if you ever visit Kazakhstan and you think you will be able to access Baikonur Cosmodrome, then you will probably require a Russian visa or a Russian passport to access this place. It's quite interesting. Now let's talk about all the important things that happened with Kazakhstan recently. IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency, they opened world's first low-enriched uranium bank in Kazakhstan. Make sure that you remember this. And of course, Kazakhstan is also a non-permanent member of the United Nations Security Council for the time being. As you know, in the United Nations Security Council, there are 5 permanent members. Then there are the non-permanent members that keep changing. So for the time being, till the end of 2018 and the beginning of 2019, Kazakhstan will remain a member of the UN Security Council non-permanent seat. The major rivers of Kazakhstan, well, there are 3 mainly. The first one is Turgay. It is located in the Turgay Valley of Kazakhstan and it is quite important for the people there. Then these 2 rivers have been in the news a lot because of China. The first one is Irtysh River. The Irtysh River is a river which is also the main tributary of the Ob River. As you know, Ob River is a huge river in Asia, Eurasia actually. It passes through Russia, China and Kazakhstan. So Irtysh River is a tributary of that and it is a very important river of Kazakhstan. Recently, China tried to build a lot of dams on the Ob River primarily to target the Irtysh River and divert its flow so that this river would benefit more Chinese cities than the Kazakhstani cities. The Ishim River. The Ishim River passes through both Kazakhstan and Russia. The Ishim River is a tributary of the Irtysh River and it is slightly navigable as well. If we talk about economy, then Kazakhstan has not been doing well lately. In 2016, it only grew at 1%, although things were quite better during 2013. When Kazakhstan almost grew at 6% of its GDP, which is quite impressive for a small country like that. Well, relatively small country, it's still a quite huge country in the Central Asian region, of course. The reason for such low GDP growth rate is primarily because the exports have dipped. Kazakhstani economy is mainly dependent on their export of oil and metals. They export a lot of metals to producer countries like China, even Indonesia, Germany, and you can see all the countries that import products from Kazakhstan. Except China, oil and metal demand has dipped to a large extent in Russia, France, Germany, Italy, and Greece. That is why Kazakhstan has seen a slump in its GDP growth rate. But the World Bank estimates that after 2019, we might see Kazakhstan growing at 3%, which is still quite underwhelming, I would say, because even a country like Pakistan is growing at 5% of its GDP. So Kazakhstan certainly can do a lot better. Even with a sluggish growth rate, Kazakhstan is still the largest economy in Central Asia. Its GDP size is around $461 billion in terms of PPP. Let's talk about India-Kazakhstan relations now. Well, for exam point of view, you must know about the military exercise between India and Kazakhstan. Although both the countries have not had a lot of time to have very deep strategic relations because Kazakhstan became an independent country in 1991 when the USSR fell apart. But India has always tried to make sure it has good relations with Kazakhstan because Kazakhstan can act as an important link for India to reach the Russian market. As you know, India is working on the North-South corridor and India will use the Iranian ports to get access to the Central Asian countries and then go beyond Russia and Europe. So in order to do that, good relations with Kazakhstan is a must. That is why India has also worked on a joint military exercise with Kazakhstan called Prabal Dostik. It means robust friendship. The 2017 edition of this military exercise was conducted in Himachal Pradesh. Of course, the 2016 edition was conducted in the Karangda area of Kazakhstan. In 2018, the exercise will probably take place in Kazakhstan again. So just make sure you remember this, Prabal Dostik, India-Kazakhstan military exercise. Well, India did indeed try to establish diplomatic relations with Kazakhstan right after its independence. India was one of the first nations to recognize Kazakhstan as an independent state. Diplomatic relations were established in February 1992, but certainly both the countries have not done enough to increase their bilateral trade. The bilateral trade between India and Kazakhstan stood at just $412 million, that is quite low. Well, we should also look at the fact that in the Central Asian countries, Kazakhstan is the largest trading partner that India has. So certainly both the countries can do much more to increase their bilateral trade. The bilateral trade is pretty much tilted in favor of Kazakhstan. They export more to India than they import. They export goods around $300 million and they import goods of around $114 million. So this is one area that India should work on as well. So overall, we can say that Kazakhstan is a young country. Its security is pretty much guaranteed by the defense pact that it has with a massive power like Russia and its neighboring countries. And in the Central Asian region, this country dominates because it has the largest population as well. Hopefully, India and Kazakhstan will develop good relations in the near future because Kazakhstan has a lot of uranium reserves as well, and India will be needing a lot of uranium reserves in the near future. That's all for now. Thanks for watching this video. God bless you all.